Good morning, everybody. Welcome to you from wherever you are watching from, and whether you're on your own or together with family or friends, welcome. This week in our Bible reading from the first chapter of Mark's Gospel, as Jesus begins his ministry, he asks four fishermen, Simon and Andrew, James and John, to come with him. And the text tells us that they immediately said yes. For them to respond without hesitation requires a lot of courage. It's life-changing. They are prepared to leave everything behind, their family businesses, and learn to fish for people with Jesus. Jesus offers to take their skills and use them for building his kingdom. How easy would it be for us to respond to a life-changing call so quickly? I invite you to join me in saying together an opening prayer. Loving Lord, thank you that you meet us where we are, in the middle and muddle of our daily tasks. Help us to hear your call, to recognize your voice, and to respond to your invitation to be with you now. Amen. Today, people change direction in life quite frequently. Almost no one has a job for life anymore, and many people will have had several careers before they retire. But I wonder what it feels like to leave a job you know really well, retrain and begin a new line of work. Tom Copeland, a member of our church family, did exactly that last year. And we're now going to hear from him as he tells us what it was like. Okay, so hi Tom.
Hi, good evening.
Hi, so tell me, if there's anyone who doesn't know who you are, do you want to say who you are?
Yes, absolutely. Been a member of the church since we moved to the village about 6 years ago. I'm married to Emily, and my children are Isabella and Susanna, who you'll probably see running around the church, dressed as fairies or dinosaurs, very similar.
That's brilliant. So, Tom, you've had a career change recently. Can you tell us what you were doing before and for how long, and then sort of what brought about that career change?
Yeah, absolutely. So I have, you know, lived and worked in the area since about 2007 when I moved to Cambridge to start doing some research at university. And then I left to work in engineering design. So I worked for a few different companies. But effectively, companies would come to us to design and develop new products. And it was everything from new food and drink items like beer and coffee and chocolate and ice cream, through to medical devices and sometimes things associated with energy. So everything from solar panels through to sort of monitoring equipment for sort of the local grid. So it's quite a varied sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting work, really nice people who I worked with, really very fascinated by the way that things work, both, you know, systems and also sort of human systems as well. And they were always thinking about how you think about a problem. So it was mm-hmm. a very stimulating place to be.
So what are you doing now?
Well, indeed. So I think the reason for wanting to make the change was that after having done that for about 15 years, I personally felt that I wasn't being challenged myself, and I kind of want to feel that I'm continuing to develop and grow, but also because at the end of the day, fundamentally, you're really helping big companies to make more money, and that's not a terribly fulfilling thing to do. So from my experience of doing sports coaching as a hobby in my spare time, I have really enjoyed watching people grow and develop over a number of years and having a hand in helping them to discover things about themselves that perhaps they wouldn't have otherwise found.
Mm-hmm.
With a number of friends over the years nagging me to get into teaching, I decided to switch careers, and Emily's been really supportive with that.
So teaching which subject?
Well, teaching mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
So I've not necessarily been led into it by the maths. I'm sure I've come across some teachers in the past who would want to talk about the beauty and the elegance and the aesthetic enjoyment of wonderfully built mathematics. But I think see it more from the personal development side of things, that I think it's a really fascinating subject where people have a lot of anxiety about it. People don't want to be seen to fail. And so as a result, the relationship you have with maths isn't the same as it might be with, say, history or geography or English or art, where failure is perhaps viewed as less of a reflection of your natural ability. And I really hope that through the subject, I can help people kind of learn where the limits of their ability lie. And then through application and through trying, you know, push back those boundaries so they can improve themselves and build their self-confidence as a result, carry that self-confidence into other areas of their lives.
So what's it felt like to retrain and begin a completely new sort of line of work?
Really exciting. It's really good fun. I'm enjoying being in front of the kids. I know some teachers are quite anxious.
Not a bit scary at times?
No. No, I mean, it's a strange time to be learning to teach. It is not usual. And all the teachers who are helping us to learn are constantly apologising for the situation. But no, I mean, the kids are good. You know, they do have to go to school. They're not there by choice necessarily.
Is this primary school children or secondary?
Well, this is secondary. This is secondary children. So we're looking at that exciting transition from being about 11 years old through to about 18 years old, where they are perfectly balanced human beings at all times, and rationally.
Okay. So exciting and not scary, but exciting.
So far, yes. Yeah. I think the stressful side of the job is probably going to be associated with a lot of the admin that goes with it. There's a lot of responsibility that's been put onto teachers, and interesting, if you go to countries like Germany, they don't have they have years where there are just no new teachers required because no one's left the profession, whereas in the UK the approach is to set up a new institute of teaching to ram even more teachers into one of the funnel because it's gonna be so leaky along the way.
So today we've been looking at a story of fishermen who left their nets and their boats and started something very new with Jesus. So does your experience relate in any way to that story?
I think when you're setting off on a new and uncertain journey, there are doubts that you're going to have, that you are making a change which is perhaps not going to turn out for the best. If you have got people who rely on you, like your family, and you've got bills to pay and the mortgage to pay, and you don't have the ability just to move something to a different part of the country, then you're taking a risk. And luckily for me, I've had the support of my family through this sort of change as I continue to move in towards teaching, and we're in a fortunate position whereby financially we're okay. But I can imagine that having a sudden change like that, it carries risks with it and it carries anxieties with it. But that kind of says to me that the pull that pulled them away from what they've been previously doing and, the responsibilities they would have had to their families must have been tremendous.
They left a lot behind, didn't they? Okay, that's really helpful, Tom. So thanks for your time and thanks for the insight into that change and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Our first hymn today is "I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene," as we think about how the early disciples felt to be called by Jesus on the shore of Galilee. Let's sing.
Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder.
reading today comes from Mark's Gospel and is read by Alice.
A reading from Mark chapter 1, starting at verse 14. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him.
Thank you, Alice. At the beginning of our Bible passage today, Jesus is wandering along the beach next to the Sea of Galilee, watching people at work. He approaches Simon and Andrew, two brothers, and interrupts their daily work, casting their nets into the sea, with a very strange proposal. "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of people." The text tells us that they immediately put down their nets and follow. He then wanders a little further and comes across James and John, who with their father were in their boat mending their nets. Immediately he called them, we read, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and went away after him. Had I been in either boat that day, I'm not so sure I'd have responded so readily. We have to assume, though, that there was more to the conversation than what's recorded in the Gospel, and that this wasn't the first time that Simon and Andrew, James and John had come across Jesus. It's likely that they'd been in the crowd as Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. They'd have heard his message that the kingdom of God is near, and may well have stayed to talk long after the rest of the crowd had drifted away. No doubt they'd already felt the magic of his presence and the power of what he had to say. Working men in a rural area don't simply leave their livelihood, particularly when it's a family business, and wander off up the road with some stranger who's just appeared and said something very bizarre to them. But maybe this is Mark's point. Something in what Jesus said gave each set of brothers a glimpse of a new way of seeing. And this was enough to tease their imagination and tickle their curiosity. Whatever was said between Jesus and the two sets of brothers, and whatever they might or might not have understood Jesus to be about, we know that they responded to his call and went with him. But this means they had to leave some things behind. A feature of Mark's understanding of what it meant for people to respond to Jesus' call to see and live differently is that it always involved leaving some things behind. In other words, there's always a cost to discipleship, always a change of circumstances. In one sense, we see this throughout the scriptures, both the old and the new. Abraham and Sarah had to leave Ur in order to follow God's call. The blessing of all nations through him can only be realised if Abraham leaves and goes on a journey. Similarly, Moses had to leave Egypt and then later the home and place of refuge and security in order to follow God's call. He also had to leave behind his reluctance, lack of self-confidence, and fear of failure. Throughout the Bible, there are countless examples of people who, however feebly and falteringly, followed God's call by leaving behind either places, things, securities, or people. But if we're honest, Jesus isn't asking of them anything he hasn't already done himself. Furthermore, it's unrealistic anyway to think that it's ever possible to go on a journey from one place to another, taking everything with you. However much we try, it simply can't be done. In calling Simon and Andrew and then James and John from their ordinary work that day, Jesus is making it clear that anyone who chooses to go with him for a walk up the beach must leave something behind in order to go. What's more, these two sets of brothers have no idea what lies in store for them, where the journey will take them, or how their lives will ultimately change. And Jesus doesn't tell them, not in this passage or at this point in time. Jesus called these simple folk. They weren't drawn from the religious elite or the aristocracy. They were fishermen, ordinary people. He called them from their ordinary day's work, catching fish and mending nets, with a simple summons. Follow me. Follow me. And what does he offer them? He offers them a task. He called them not to a life of ease, but to a life of service. He called them to a task in which they'd have to spend themselves and burn themselves up, and in the end die for his sake and for the sake of others. He called them to a task wherein they could win something for themselves only by giving their all to him and to others. In short, these first disciples had no idea of what lay in store for them. All that they had to rely on was the knowledge that Jesus had called them to see differently, to be brave enough and curious enough to want to explore what this might mean, and to be reckless enough to trust that the relationship with Jesus is enough to make the rest of it seem less important or vital. Happiness is never once offered or guaranteed. All that is promised is a journey with Jesus into the unknown. Discipleship still starts here, even 2,000 years later, and in a very different place and culture. We heard from Tom how it felt to change career, and I imagine that many of the skills he'd already acquired were transferable into teaching. We think of fishermen. They need the patience and the ability to endure hours in the hot sun or the cold wind. They need to notice the movement of the water that reveals the presence of the fish. They need strength to haul a big fish and gentleness to land it. These are all transferable qualities. Sharing God's message also demands patience and endurance, sensitivity to other people, and careful attention to the ways of bringing them into Jesus's presence. No wonder Jesus spoke about becoming fishers of people. But what about the skills that we've developed over the course of our work and lives? How might God make use of these as resources for sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with our family, with our friends, and our neighbours? I love that the disciples were in their daily routine when Jesus came and called them. With so much to do and pressure from others to work, especially in the family business and to make money, it had been easy for them to have put Jesus off to a time when it was more convenient, or simply to have ignored him. I wonder where in our daily routines Jesus is speaking to us. Are we missing his voice as we struggle to complete all that is expected of us by family, colleagues, and friends? If we were to hear him, what would we expect him to say? And would we be willing to change what we're doing if he asks us to? And I invite you to listen to a prayer by the monastic and mystic Thomas Merton. And if it's a prayer that you can relate to, then maybe join me in saying Amen at the end. Lord, we often have no idea where we're going. We don't see the road ahead and cannot know for certain where it will lead. Nor do we really know ourselves, and the fact that we think we're following your will does not mean that we're actually doing so. But we believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and we hope that we have that desire in all we do. We hope that we'll never do anything apart from that desire. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Cheryl will now lead us in our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. When I say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you lead us by example and left your Father to come to earth. We ask you for the courage to see things differently, to be brave and curious, and to explore what you are calling us to do. We thank you that you are still calling people to work with you and for you. Help us to make time to listen for your voice so that in the clamour of things calling for our attention, we don't miss what you are saying to us. Let us be willing to make changes so we can journey with you, learn from you, and share what we know with those around us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we pray for our leaders, Stephen and Justin, our archbishops, Stephen and Dagmar, our bishops, Linda and the PCC here in the parish. Give them wisdom as they make decisions about how to keep your church family safe and in touch with you and one another. We pray too for our political leaders, for Joe Biden as he begins his time as president in the unsettled USA, for leaders in countries where natural disasters and wars, as well as their pandemic, are impacting their population, and for our own government as they seek to make decisions that balance what is right for people's health and well-being with the economy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who work in the health service. Thank you for their commitment and compassion. We pray that over the coming weeks and months, you would be close to them, giving them stamina and patience as they continue to deal with dizzying numbers of patients. We pray for all those who are in hospital, for those waiting for treatment that has been delayed, and for all those who are unwell at home. Bless them, Lord, and those who care for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Lord, we say again that we often have no idea where we're going. We don't see the road ahead and cannot know for certain where it will lead. Nor do we really know ourselves, and the fact that we think we're following your will doesn't mean we're actually doing so. But we believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you, and we hope that we have that desire in all that we do. We hope that we'll never do anything apart from that desire. In Jesus' name, Amen. Believing that God is with us and leading us, we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Cheryl. Our next hymn is Christ is the One Who Calls, the One Who Loved and Came, to whom by right it falls to bear the highest name. And still today, our hearts are stirred to hear his word and walk his way. It's true for us today as it was for the first disciples 2,000 years ago. Let's sing.
Oh,
thank you for joining with us for worship today. Very few of us will be called, like those first disciples, to leave behind everything for something new. But as you go through this week, maybe if you keep a diary, you can write in the margins how God might be speaking to you through the ordinary things you do each day. Maybe he's nudging you to try something new as you continue on your journey of faith. Remember that we have evening prayer through Zoom this evening at 6 o'clock. Let me know if you'd like to join but don't have the link. And both Bible study groups on a Tuesday night and a Friday afternoon have resumed. If you want to join either, just let me know and I'll send you the details. If you're watching this service at the usual service time of 10:30, a reminder that we meet at 11 o'clock for coffee and chat over Zoom. If you've not joined before, maybe today is the day. We'd love to see you. The link is in the email that Matt sent out on Wednesday, or you can just let me know and I'll send it to you. Our sending out prayer this week is the same prayer with which we began our service. Let's say it together. Loving Lord, thank you that you meet us where we are, in the middle and muddle of our daily tasks. Help us to hear your call, to recognize your voice, and to respond to your invitation to be with you right now. Amen. Go in peace to love, serve, and enjoy the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. Have a good week and goodbye.